start the preview.
Okay.
Thank you.
At the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that he is the Lord. And one day that will be the reality in all of creation, where all are called to worship him. We begin this morning on page 355 in the Book of Common Prayer on page 2 of your bulletins. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. The author and giver of all good things, graft in our hearts the love of your name, increase in us true religion, nourish us with all goodness, and bring forth in us the fruit of good works through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. And now let us turn our hearts to the reading of God's most holy word.
The first reading is from Jeremiah chapter 15. O Lord, you know, remembering me and visit me, and bring down retribution for me on my persecutors. In your forbearance, do not take me away. Know that on your account I suffer insult. Your words were found, and I ate them. And your words became to me a joy and the delight of my heart. For I am called by your name, O Lord God of hosts. I did not sit in the company of merrymakers, nor did I rejoice. Under the weight of your hand I sat alone, for you had filled me with indignation. Why is my pain unceasing, my wound incurable, refusing to be healed? Truly, you are to me like a deceitful brook, like waters that fail. Therefore, thus says the Lord, if you turn back, I will take you back, and you shall stand before me. If you utter what is precious and not what is worthless, you shall serve as my mouth. It is they who will turn to you, not you who will turn to them. And I will make you to this people a fortified wall of bronze. They will fight against you, but they shall not prevail over you. For I am with you to save and deliver you, says the Lord. I will deliver you out of the hand of the wicked and redeem you from the grasp of the ruthless. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm reading is from Psalm chapter 26. Please recite with me. Give judgment for me, O Lord, for I have lived in integrity. I have trusted in the Lord and have not faltered. Test me, O Lord, and try me. Examine my heart and my mind. For your love is compromised. I have not faithfully with you. I have not sat with the worthless, nor do I consort with the deceitful. I have hated the company of evildoers. I will not sit down the wicked. I will wash my hands in innocence, O Lord, that I might go oppression around your altar. Sing aloud a song of thanksgiving and recounting all your wonderful deeds. Lord, I love this house in which you dwell, and the place where your glory abides. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. The second reading is from Romans chapter 12. Let love be genuine. Hate what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with mutual affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not lag in zeal. Be ardent in spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in suffering. Persevere in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints. Extend hospitality to strangers. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Do not claim to be wiser than you are. Do not repay anyone evil for evil, but take thought for what is noble in the sight of all. If it is possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave room for the wrath of God. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. No. If your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they are thirsty, give them something to drink. For by doing this, you will heap burning coals on their heads. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. Glory to you, Lord Christ. Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and undergo great suffering at the hands of the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed, and on the third day be raised. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, "God forbid it, Lord, this must never happen to you." But he turned and said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me, for you are setting your mind not on the divine things, but on human things." Then Jesus told his disciples, "If anyone want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it. For what will it profit them if they gain the whole world but forfeit their life? Or what will they give in return for their life? For the Son of Man is to come with his angels in glory, in the glory of his Father, and then he will repay everyone for what has been done. Truly I tell you, there are some standing here who will not taste death before they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ. I knew I was missing something. Well, there's a verse for everything, so. Let love be genuine. Hate what is evil, hold fast to what is good. Love one another with mutual affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. Have you ever met somebody on the street, just randomly run into somebody, have a conversation, and felt that they were just different? I mean, they had a different spirit, maybe a different way of carrying themselves. There was something that was different, yet somehow familiar. And then you find out later that, oh, that person's a Christian. You're like, oh, I should have realized that. Like, you're not surprised. And sometimes we meet a brother or sister out in the world, out in the wild, and there's a connection there. There's something that you sense that sets that relationship apart. There's one thing that I've said a lot lately, and that is this. According to the Bible, there are how many types of people? Thank you. According to the Bible, there are only two types of people in the world. There are those who are of the world and those who belong to the kingdom of Christ. In Proverbs, there are the foolish and the wise. In Psalms, there are those who are godly and those who run after other gods. And there are those who believe that God is God and we are not. And those who act as if they themselves are gods. And in the past, you know, Christianity has been the dominant faith in this country, in our culture, and we didn't really see a significant contrast between these two camps of people. There was a particular ethic that people lived by, that they held in common. And Christians are not perfect by any stretch, but by and large, most people dealt with this tension of putting other people first. Theologians and sociologists today are beginning to say that we live in a post-Christian world, whatever that means. And whether or not Christianity is waning, holding on to any type of Christian ethic really is. And as this balance has shifted, as we've watched our society and we watch too much of the news, the distinction between these two categories seem to be becoming more and more apparent. Selflessness is replaced with selfishness. Community is replaced by this hyper individualism. And basic things like having and sharing a fundamental basis for truth, these things can't be taken for granted anymore. And it leaves us with a question. As Christians, how are we then supposed to live? I mean, in light of this shift in our culture, how do we live our lives? How do we respond to this cultural shift? And more importantly than that, where do we find our own hope when hopes of the world really begin to fade? The reason that the traits of the Christian life stand out when we see them in others is because they're indications of who we are in Christ. When one becomes a believer in Christ, a transformation begins to take place. And this is what we're looking at. When we get to Romans chapter 12, we're looking at what the Christian life begins to look like. And so when scriptures say things like, be transformed, it is as much an indication of what takes place in the hearts of believers as it is a command. Now, last week we talked a little bit about transformation. And remember, in the beginning of this chapter, Paul appeals to us that in light of everything that Christ has done for us, in light of all that he's done for salvation, in light of all that he's done to bring us to himself, that we ought to, what? Present ourselves as living, holy, acceptable sacrifices to God. He calls this our worship, and then he urges us to be transformed. To be transformed by the renewing of our minds. He calls all of us to this new understanding of who we are in Christ and how that looks in our daily lives. And yet, as we talked about last week, we live in this thing called the already and not yet, thank you. The already and the not yet. See, our redemption in Christ has been secured. It was secured on the cross. It's secured through a work of God that he has done for us. But on the other hand, we have not yet fully received. We have not yet received the fullness of our redemption. And there's this tension that lies in between. And the thing is, one day we will exchange these sinful, dying bodies for redeemed new bodies that will carry us through eternity. We will no longer suffer from the brokenness and the indignity of sin. And sin itself has already been defeated on the cross, but not yet been eradicated from the earth. Are you tracking with me? Does that make sense? That that redemption, the fullness, comes when Christ returns. This is our hope of salvation. But there's that tension. There's tension between those two poles. And that's where we live today, between the already and not yet. And this transformation begins to take place when he calls us to himself, when he redeems us. And that's what the rest of Paul's letter is about. Everything before chapter 12 is about what God has done. How bad we are, how much need we are of redemption, and oh, by the way, this is what God has done. And every one of the traits that we read this morning are a result, they're a picture of Christ working out his life in ours. Things like our love becomes genuine. We begin to hate the things that God hates. We hold on to the things that are good, and we outdo each other in showing honor. All this happens when we become filled with the Holy Spirit. He begins to work in us and churn in our hearts and transform us. We move from pride to humility. We begin to recognize our own struggles with sin, and that our hearts are still motivated by the flesh. But we begin to discover this wisdom that God gives us to know when to lay aside ourselves, when to lay aside our agendas. I mean, what is offering ourselves up as a sacrifice, as we were told? Well, one thing, it's not spending all of our lives making our lives better. It involves tending to the needs of others. And it takes place mostly in the mundane things of life. See, here's the thing. We serve a God who became flesh. But Christianity is not life that's spent on some mountaintop, but it's lived out in the trenches of real life. It's the ordinary day in and day out struggle with sin and how we deal with that, and at the same time extend hospitality and putting other people first. It's this struggle to pursue peace, to love others, and to refrain from striking back at someone. And see, this is the other thing. This is that whole second paragraph that Paul calls us to. It's about not pursuing justice on our own behalf. Because this transformation involves living in harmony with others. It's living in harmony with each other on his own terms. See, we refrain pursuing vengeance because, one of the reasons, because this life isn't the only thing that we have. That's part of the promise that's been given us. We're promised so much more than just this existence on earth. See, when this is the only life you have, when this is the only hope you have, it makes sense to fight for all the territory that you can get. But when we are transformed into an eternal kingdom with eternal pursuits and eternal rewards, and we no longer need to fight and scrape for all the things that we want or think we deserve in this life, because we are promised so much more. And Paul doesn't call us necessarily to embrace injustice. In some ways, the Bible does say, accept injustice against ourselves, not turning the other cheek at certain times, and things like that. But what he's doing here in this passage, he is encouraging us to embrace God's justice. Who do you think can enact justice more thoroughly and more righteously, you or God? Personally, I don't have a problem letting God sort out the evils that are perpetrated against me. I really don't. Because our God is concerned with justice. And He doesn't just say, I get to decide, which is true. What Paul is saying is God reserves the right to defend his children. And that releases us from the need of defending ourselves. So when he calls us to love our enemy, when he calls us to not respond in kind, when he calls us, it's because we can rely on a God who will set all things right. When the Holy Spirit enters the life of the believer, we're taken out of this kingdom of darkness, we're placed in the kingdom of light, and we begin to reflect that light that comes from our Savior. And these are all the things that we see listed in chapter 12. And yet there's that tension. There's that tension that I described earlier. Each of these describe who we are in Christ. They are indications, they're indicatives, but they also are commands. They are imperatives. This is what we ought to do. Because in the already, but not yet, we won't get these things right all the time. Thank God for forgiveness. But it doesn't mean that we get to just give in to the culture. It doesn't mean that we just act like the world. And this is exactly what we see in the gospel. This is when we come in and we see this interaction with Peter. So if you remember last week, Peter had just received some of Jesus' highest praise. Jesus asked the question, who do you all say that I am? And Peter's answer got an A+. He knocked it out of the park. And not only that, Jesus says, this faith that you just described in your response, this faith is going to be the foundation of this new family that's going to be created. Your faith is going to be the bedrock of the church. And then not 6 verses later, Jesus calls Peter the devil. What in the world is that about? Talk about going from like the heights to the depths. Only Peter can pull that off. By the way, this is not part of my sermon. One of these days, I'm going to write a book about Peter. Because I so identify with him. You know the phrase? The man was built with he was born with a silver foot in his mouth. I love it. Anyhow. Despite having the right answer earlier about who Jesus was. See, here's the thing. And this is the key. Peter is still stuck on the world's definition of success. Jesus describes how his mission is going to end in failure. Instead of riding in on a white stallion, leading the armies against Rome, he's going to be dragged in chains, beaten, and killed. And Peter says, no, not on my watch. And Jesus wheels on him. My boys understand that. Here's the thing. Don't read this as some flannel graph picture of Jesus gently rebuking Peter, saying, now, Peter, you know, you're just not thinking about it the right way. You don't really know what you're saying. You'll learn soon enough. No. Jesus rips him a new one, as my daddy used to say. See, what Peter presented to Christ in that moment was the very real option that Jesus could do it his own way and avoid the tremendous suffering that he would face on the cross. Jesus could have disobeyed his father. And Peter's words were a great temptation. We don't see it in the text, but Jesus might have been thinking in his head, don't you know, Peter, that I already thought of that? But then Jesus, he points out this very difference that I mentioned at the beginning. There's two kinds of people in the world. And Jesus looks at Peter and says, you're setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things. And the reality is that like Peter, I think sometimes, maybe more often than we care to admit, we still do the same thing ourselves. I mean, what does it mean to choose human things over divine things? Well, it's certainly not blessing those who persecute you. It's not living in harmony with one another. It is seeking our own vengeance. It's not living peaceably with all, and it is loving evil and being disingenuous with our love for others. And it's definitely not about accepting a plan that includes our suffering. See, the Christian life is about suffering. There's just no way around that. We can sugarcoat the scriptures all we want, but we are told that there is suffering in this life. And especially today, it's like our culture has this tremendous entitlement to avoid suffering. And the foolish will tell you to stand up and fight for your rights, eradicate your suffering. But sometimes God's plan for our lives involves a great amount of suffering. Why? I don't know. But it says so right here. There's this great cartoon. I love it. It's a picture of Christians being led into the Colosseum to be devoured by lions. And above the tunnel, there's a sign, and it reads this: God loves you and has a wonderful plan for your life. There's only one consistent expectation that is laid out in scriptures for the life of the believer, and it is a life experienced through the cross. That's why Jesus says, you want to follow me? Take up your cross. And that's not, take up your cross is not, okay, it's time to quit smoking, or, you know, time to stop chewing tobacco, or, you know, time to stop watching R-rated movies, or, you know, I don't know, time to, like, I don't know. It's not that. He says, take up your cross with me and follow me to death. No way around it. And we don't do death in this culture. Ways of the world, ways of heaven. We don't do death in this culture. Why? Because we're winners. We're winners. We pull ourselves up by our bootstraps and we move on. Don't get me wrong. It's important to be personally responsible and take care of your needs. And you know, I like the whole pull yourselves up by the bootstraps idea. But we need to understand that balanced with that is a call to sacrifice. And both Jesus and Paul in these scriptures are calling us to a life of sacrifice, not picking up our lives, but laying them down. And whatever that means for us, God will certainly let us know. Here's the thing. Christians are a peculiar people. We don't and probably shouldn't most of the time live up to the expectations of the world. That's because when we have our eyes focused on Christ and we remember the promise of glory and a whole new life that awaits us. And this hopefully kind of puts all of the mess around us in perspective a little bit. It makes it a little easier for us to put up with each other, to truly love and forgive, let love cover a multitude of sins, to embrace each other when, you know, we just don't really want to embrace. We don't feel like it, no matter what we feel like it. It helps us live a life that's not full of so much tension and grief because we're not getting the things that we think we deserve. See, there's... And then the other thing is this, is that there are two types of people. I realized as I've been going through this and looking through my sermon, I realized that these are not disparate camps that one won't move into the other. Because the whole point of the gospel is that we are called to share this good news, that there's hope in the middle of all this brokenness. That there's peace in the middle of a world of unrest. And the good news is that Christ has come to give us peace and hope. And this is the story that we share. And we share it to those who are in the camp that are of the world, that are in the camp of the foolish, that are in the camp of those who set their minds on worldly things. When this is our message, when this is the light that the Christian life shows, our distinctiveness, those weird Christians, they don't act like us. That message, yes, you're right. We don't act like the rest of the world, most of the time anyway. And this is why. Because there's a story, and it's a good story. And we share this gospel so that many may enter the ranks of the wise. Hopefully all enter the ranks of the wise and become part of the kingdom of God, part of God's family, and be part of our family that we live with and embrace every day. Amen. Please stand. We have that opportunity now to confess what we believe as found in the Nicene Creed on page 7 of your bulletin and on page 358 of the Book of Common Prayer. Cite together. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Prayers of the People, Form 3. Will you pray with me responsively? Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church, that we all may be one. Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve you, that your name may be glorified by all people. We pray for Michael Curry, our presiding bishop, Gregory Brewer, our bishop, Father Rob, our rector, the United Church of South India, and Bishop D. Razalaman, St. Margaret's Church, Inverness, and Reverend Eugene Ruman, St. John's Church, Kissimmee, and Reverend Gladys Rodriguez, and for all bishops, priests, and deacons, that they may be faithful ministers of your word and sacraments. We pray for Donald Trump, President Donald Trump, Governor Ron DeSantis, Mayor Brian Nelson, and for all who govern and hold authority in all the nations of the world, that there may be justice and peace on earth. Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake,
that our words may find favor in your sight.
Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble,
that they may be delivered from their distress.
Give to the departed eternal rest.
Let thy perpetual sign upon them.
We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy.
May we also come to share in your heavenly kingdom.
Let us pray for our own needs and those of others.
Father, we do lift up our hearts to you and ask that you would hear our prayers for our own needs. We pray for this church, that you would bless it, cause it to grow in spirit and in number, that your light may shine forth and go into the world. We pray for our neighborhood and our city around us and for the state, Lord, that your gospel would go forth, that you would change hearts and bring people from foolishness into wisdom. We pray that you would minister to and bless and draw back to your church those who have walked away, those who have not found hope or peace. Lord, we pray that you would minister to them through your Holy Spirit and draw them back into your family. We thank you, Lord, that you do guide us in this path, that your Spirit does change us, that the calling to sacrifice is not a grievous one, but it's one that you equip us for. Lord, may we be drawn into our individual sacrifices, whatever they may be. Show us how to live life in giving to you and to others. And then, Lord Jesus, you said to your apostles, "Peace I give to you, my own peace I leave with you. Regard not our sins, but the faith of your church, and give to us the peace and unity of that heavenly city, where with the Father and the Holy Spirit you live and reign now and forever. Amen." And now let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Would you please stand? And now may God's peace be upon you. May he shower you with his presence. May he fill you with joy for the journey. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Again, we will take a moment and get ourselves prepared for the Eucharist by washing up in the back. Thank you for maintaining your social distance during peace. But do share love from afar so that your love may be genuine with each other this morning. And then we'll be back in just a moment. Well, good morning and welcome. It is great to be with you this glorious Sunday morning, this Lord's Day. It's good to be in service and online. I want to say welcome to all who are joining us on our live stream as well. I don't see all the faces in-house are familiar, but I want to say welcome to anybody who's joining us for the first time or who have been kind of hit and miss here lately and you're just checking us out. Thank you for being with us this morning. Thank you for joining our worship service. If you would, leave a comment in the comment section. We would love to just hear where you're from, and we'd love to acknowledge your presence with us this morning. Thank you so much. I want to start this morning by acknowledging our birthdays and anniversaries. Does anybody have a birthday that we wish to celebrate, own up to? Anybody? Okay. What about anniversaries you want to own up to? Anybody? Okay, all right. And then travel. We usually pray for travel as well. Is anybody going to brave the great outdoors? Not yet. Okay, not yet. As far as our service, I think everybody here knows how we're doing Eucharist and dismissal. I want to talk quickly about an opportunity to serve. We used to, when I was involved in InterVarsity Christian Fellowship, long time ago. We called, actually it was KP duty at camp. We called it opportunity to serve. And we have a cleanup day that's coming up in a week, right? It's this next Saturday. So next Saturday, we're going to be here at 8 o'clock in the morning, and we're going to start doing some cleanup around here. There are things that need to be picked up. There's things that need to be trimmed. There's weeds that need to be pulled. These are just kind of the regular outdoor stuff that's not picked up by our landscapers. And we definitely have people here that can put their muscles to work out there. So please come this Saturday, September 5th at 8 a.m. Definitely bring gloves. If you have a rake or two, if you have iron rake, if you have power tools, I'm going to bring my trimmer. So I've got that, and so anything, a blower, actually I need to bring my blower too. Just bring tools and prepare to get to work and get dirty. Then also, let's see, I wanted to talk recently, many of you have heard about some new guidelines that the diocese just put out, I believe on Friday, about our meeting together. And I wanted to, first of all, acknowledge those and encourage you. Actually, we didn't expect a shift in guidelines until much later in the fall. So the fact that they're coming out now, right before the 1st of September, that's really good news. If you've been watching the news, the numbers of the pandemic are coming down. Less and less people are getting infected. Part of it, we're being diligent with this. We're being diligent with distancing. We need to keep doing that. I want you to know that these guidelines are out. We have not, for the moment, we're not changing anything. Your vestry needs to sit down and go over these guidelines and go over the opportunities that now have been opened up to us. We need to make sure that we're ready. We need to make sure that the decisions that we make are appropriate for our family. So just know that in the meantime, we're keeping the service, we're keeping this service, we're keeping drive through Eucharist. There's no coffee hour yet, but now we're excited because we're moving forward to where we're going to get back to having fellowship time and Bible study time. And that's really all I want to say about that. And then just, I want to encourage you all, thank you again for supporting. And because things, passing the plate is different, and we can't pass plate through the live stream. So please, if you're watching us, don't forget to give. Please support us either through the website, through text to give, or just snail mail. Send a check to the church for your pledge and any offerings to help keep this going. There's still expenses from the lights to, I don't want to go through the whole thing, but we need your support to keep the church going forward. Thank you so much. I think that's it as far as the announcements. Okay. As we move into our time at the table. Our offertory sentence comes from Romans chapter 12. I appeal to you, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present yourselves as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Please stand. As we come to this table, I remind us that this is the Lord's table. This is not the church's table. It's not mine. The Lord presents himself to us every time we come to Eucharist. And as such, if you're a baptized member in the Christian faith in any denomination, this is for you. This is grace. God comes to us in the Word, and he comes to us in the sacrament. And so he extends himself to us right now in this moment, in this space. That's pretty good. Amen. So please do come. If you wish to receive just a blessing, that's okay too. Please come and indicate so by crossing your arms over your chest, and I'll know.
The Lord be with you. And also with you, lift up your heart. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give him thanks and praise. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For you are the source of light and life. You made us in your image and called us to new life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Holy, holy,
Please kneel as you are able. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you, in your mercy, sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms on the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. And we celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen." Alleluia, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia. The gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you. Feed on him in your hearts through faith and with thanksgiving. Post-communion prayer comes from page 365 in the Book of Common Prayer. It's on page 12 of your bulletin. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Before I pronounce the blessing, in fact, would you please stand with me? Before I pronounce the blessing and dismiss, if it's been awkward for you, the end of the service, it's been awkward for us. We've been like playing it by ear, trying to figure out, okay, how do we do this without a recessional? And so it's just been kind of odd. And so somebody made a comment in Vestry this week, hey, why don't we do this? And so, yeah, that's probably a good idea. So what we're going to do is I'm going to give the blessing, and then we're going to sing the general thanksgiving. You've heard this several times. This is a prayer that comes from the Book of Common Prayer. It's in the morning prayer. If you've been joining me Monday, Wednesday, and Friday at 9 a.m. live on Facebook, hint, hint, hint. If you've been joining me for morning prayer, then every day, we end with this prayer. This prayer followed by the prayer of St. Chrysostom. And so we're going to sing a song that's based on that prayer. It's a beautiful ending prayer, and it's one that I would love to get in the DNA of Church of the Holy Spirit. So I'm going to give the blessing. We're going to sing. We're going to put out the candles. because we're trying to get this out and make sure that we're all on the same page too. And then I will dismiss us. And then we'll see. Okay. All right. And we're going to be singing along with, we're going to be singing along with the track. And if you guys know any, like, instrumentalists that you want to encourage to come and be a part of our church family, that would be great too, because we're working on building out our worship team and that whole back of the room. So we would love to be able to do this live. Today we're not, but y'all still need to sing. Got it? Bueno? ¿Está bien? ¿Está bien? Okay. All right. So where did I leave off? The blessing. Oh, Lord, your grace is so appreciated. His and yours. And now, may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, guard your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you now and forevermore. Amen. Oh, yeah.
Almighty God, Father of all mercies, hear me, your unworthy servant, give you humble thanks. For you are good and full of loving kindness, pouring out your love to us and all whom you have made.
You turn it up a little bit, Brennan.
We bless you, Lord, for our creation, preservation, and the blessings of this life. But most of all, for your immeasurable love, the redemption of the world by Jesus Christ. For the means of grace and the hope of glory. And give us such awareness of your mercies, that with truly thankful hearts we may show forth your praise. Not only with our lips, but in our whole lives, giving up ourselves to serve you, walking in your ways, in holiness and righteousness, all of our days and now through Jesus Christ.
And now, let us go forth into the world rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. Alleluia.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia.